Why do bond prices fall when interest rates increase and bond prices rise when interest rates decline? This is a basic bond concept you need to understand in order to do fixed income investing. Consider an investor who bought a newly issued 30-year treasury bond that yields 2%. The bond pays $20 in interest annually for every $1,000 of bond face value. The face value is the price of the bond that the interest payment is based on. So it's the initial price when the bond is issued. If interest rates rise to 3%, then an investor who buys a newly issued 30-year bond would receive $30 in annual interest. Seeing that an investor can now buy a new bond that pays $30 in interest while the old one pays only $20 means the old bond's price must fall to a level that an investor would be economically indifferent investing in either of the two bonds. In other words, the price of the old bond must fall to a level that an investor would make the same amount of money holding the old bond as he or she would owning the new bond. The degree to which a bond's price changes as interest rates fluctuate depends on when the bond matures. By matures means it returns its face value or principal amount. It also depends that price sensitivity depends on interest rate, or the price sensitivity to interest rate depends on the bond's yield, its coupon payment, and other features such as can the bond be called in early. A bond or a bond portfolio's price sensitivity to changing interest rates is known as its duration. And duration is essentially the weighted average maturity of a bond or bond portfolio's cash flows. So you have all these cash flows. It's the weighted average maturity of the cash flows. A 30-year bond receives cash payments in the form of interest for 3 decades compared to just a few years for a 5-year bond. Consequently, the duration or the weighted average maturity of the cash flows for a 30-year bond will be much higher than for a 5-year bond. And the duration or the weighted average maturity of these cash flows will always be less than the bond's maturity. So if the bond has a 30-year maturity because it gets cash flows all the way through, it's the weighted average maturity of the cash flows itself is going to be less than the actual maturity of the bond. And with the exception of a certain type of bond called a zero coupon bond. In a zero coupon bond, doesn't make interest payments. It makes only one payment at the end of the bond's life. And at that point, it pays the principal value and accrued interest. And so because all the cash flows are at the end when the bond matures, then the bond's duration equals its maturity. But for most bonds, the duration is less than its maturity. And these are very, very important concepts to understand bond investing. I often get questions from members of the Money for the Rest of Us Hub because they're saying, well, why is this particular bond fund so much more volatile as rates have changed than another fund or ETF? And by and large, it's due to the fund's duration. The higher or longer a bond or bond portfolio's duration, the more its price will change as interest rates change. And that is why an exchange-traded fund that invested in treasury bonds with maturity greater than 20 years appreciated over 20% as rates fell 1% this year between January and July. While an ETF that invested in bonds with maturities of 7 to 10 years only appreciated just over 8%. The latter ETF had a shorter duration than the ETF that invested in bonds with maturities greater than 20 years. Now, a rule of thumb for duration is a bond's price will increase or decrease by its duration multiplied by 1%. For each 1 percentage point change in interest rates. I'm going to give an example because that's a math formula which is hard to convey over audio. But here's an example. If interest rates rise by 1%, a bond portfolio with a duration of 6 years will fall 6%, right? So rates go up 1%. We have a 6-year duration. times 1% is 6 times 1% is 6%. So for every 1% increase or decrease in interest rates, a bond portfolio with a 6-year duration will increase or decrease by 6%. A 10-year duration portfolio will vary by 10 percentage points. Even though a bond's price fluctuates with changes in interest rates, an investor who holds the bond to maturity will receive the original face value when the bond matures, and the annualized return for holding that bond will equal the bond's yield to maturity at the time it was purchased. And so even though the price may differ from its initial face value, when you buy an individual bond, you can look at its yield to maturity, and that'll equal the annualized return if you hold that bond until it actually matures and you get the principal back. In the end, the investors made whole, even though it may have been a bumpy ride as interest rates changed along the way. But most investors don't own individual bonds. They own bonds through mutual funds or exchange-traded funds. The managers of these investment vehicles don't necessarily hold the bonds to maturity, and they are always buying and selling bonds based on cash flows into and out of the fund or ETF. Consequently, the bond fund and ETF investors are subject to interest rate risk. So the ETF is going up in value based on interest rates. And since the ETF life is indefinite, the only way that you can get your rate of return to equal the yield to maturity of the fund or ETF that you bought at the time you buy it is to have a long enough holding period, 7 years or more. Then the starting yield to maturity, and you can look it up when you buy an ETF, go on Morningstar or some other site and look at, it's usually, if you're a U.S.-based investor, it's called the SEC yield. So that essentially is a yield to maturity less the expense ratio on the fund. And that is the most important number when it comes to bond investing. Look at what the starting yield to maturity is. If it's an individual bond, you hold the bond to maturity, you'll get that rate of return. If it's a fund or ETF, you're going to have to hold it for 7 to 10 years. If rates go up and you sell within 2 years, you're going to show a loss depending on the duration of the fund. While bond fund and ETF investor can be hurt in the short term if interest rates increase, by holding it for 7 years or more, again, their total annualized return for the 7 to 10 year period will approximately equal the fund or ETF starting yield to maturity. And the reason for this is the initial loss due to rising interest rate is offset over time by the fund or ETF receiving and reinvesting income at higher interest rates. I mean, essentially, so you're, because the bond fund is, you're getting dividends, and if they're being reinvested, then it's being reinvested at a higher interest rate, because that's what yield to maturity is based on. A yield to maturity assumes the interest you're receiving is being reinvested back in the fund or ETF, or being invested at current interest rates. Here's an example. So many investors own the Vanguard Total Bond Market Index Fund. Its current SEC yield is around 2%. Now, this is a bond that's seeking to replicate the bond market. Its duration is pretty long, about 5.8 years. And so that means if interest rates increase 1%, the bond fund can fall 6%. In fact, at some point, sort of through July, this Vanguard Total Bond Market Index Fund was up over 6% year-to-date because interest rates had fallen. Now, with interest rates rising, the fund has given up much of that ground. But an investor who holds that fund, they bought it today and held it for 7 to 10 years, if they calculated their holding period annualized return of that fund, it would be around 2% if they hold it long enough. Somebody that bought it in July, though, when rates were very, very, very low, and then you've seen rates increase, is now sitting with a loss of around 6%. Now, over time, that loss will be recouped as the interest payments are received and reinvested back in the fund.